Coming up, a miracle on Christmas Eve.
Jesus was straightening out that crooked foot.
Becomes the best gift of all.
And I could see down the hallway a little bit, and here she comes walking. And it's like, no way.
On today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to the show. On December 25th, we will all be celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. And on December 24th, Emma McKinley will be celebrating because that's the day her prayer was answered.
For 18 years, Emma was confined to a wheelchair and suffered chronic pain, and yet she never stopped praying. And then on one Christmas Eve, Emma received a miracle from the hand of Jesus himself.
Easter weekend, 1993, Emma McKinley lost her balance and fell from a storage loft at work. Her foot was lodged between boxes and her body hung upside down until a coworker found her and called 911.
My head hit something very hard, and I did not come to until the next day.
As Emma healed from the wound she received in the fall, she developed widespread reflex sympathetic dystrophy, known as RSD, a chronic and progressive nerve disorder that left her entire body in severe pain.
I partnered up with God because this accident was bigger than I could handle. And I knew that I needed to know Jesus more in my life now than ever before.
Eventually, Emma was bound to a wheelchair. Kathy Rutterberg has been her caregiver for the last 18 years.
She could not walk at all. She was in her wheelchair 24/7 with the exception of toileting, and she's been like that for many, many years.
Eventually, that pain got so bad in that foot and in the left hand that the foot started to grow crooked.
Emma's left hand closed into a fist she was unable to open. Her neck and spine twisted to the left, leaving her body in an awkward and painful position. Her son Jason saw how hard life had become for his mother.
It was difficult to see her just doing daily things. You can see the pain in her face, you know, and it's hard to see somebody go through that, you know, much less a family member.
Through the years, Emma maintained a positive attitude despite her painful situation.
No matter how rough her life was physically, she's always had just a bright smile on her face and always been so warm and so encouraging. And the other thing that I've never seen waver is her faith.
I kept pressing forward each and every day, knowing that Jesus was going to give me that strength, that he was going to be there for me. And he never let me down. He was there for me.
Blood clots formed in her legs, which posed life-threatening issues. Doctors wanted to amputate both of her legs, but Emma refused.
I never gave up. I kept praying and thanking God for my healing because I had that much faith in my Jesus to know that someday he was going to give me that healing.
The night before Christmas Eve 2011, Emma fell out of her wheelchair. For 8 hours, she lay on the floor in excruciating pain, crying out to Jesus for help. Emma says that Jesus came into her room and reached out to touch her.
And what I saw was the most awesome white robe. I knew who that was. Our human eyes, we can't even hardly look at it. It's so bright white. I couldn't see it, but I could feel that left foot going from this position to this position. Jesus was straightening out that crooked foot. I knew my neck was being straightened, my spine was being straightened. That left hand that had been clenched fist for over 18 years. Jesus started to take those fingers and open them up. and I could take that hand and I could flex it and use my fingers. Jesus was now kneeling on one knee right beside me, and he extended his hand out to me, asking for mine. And then we stood up together, and even though the bones were sounding and cracking like crazy, he still had a hold of my hands. Then I knew I had to start walking and use his feet and legs, and I did.
Just a few hours later, Emma's two sons and her grandchildren came over to celebrate Christmas Eve, unaware of the miracle their mother just experienced.
And I could see down the hallway a little bit, and here she comes walking. And it's like, no way. I hadn't seen Mom out of a wheelchair, I think, since my wedding in 1993. At that moment, everything I knew was different because, you know, she's supposed to be in the chair, but she's walking. And it was just a surreal moment seeing her walk. It's like, it's a miracle. There's nothing else it could be.
We kind of got through hugging my two sons. I went over and grabbed those two grandsons, and I gave them a big hug for the first time in all those years.
That night, Emma and her family were in awe of God's love and power as they celebrated her Christmas miracle. Emma says that being able to stand and walk on her own has changed her life forever. Although she still has RSD symptoms, she and her family believe that God is in control. Today, with her son Jason, Emma joyfully shares her story of how Jesus heard her prayers and forever changed her life on Christmas Eve.
You know, this is such a story of hope. This miracle is not just for my mom, not just for our family, but it's for everybody. Whatever difficulties people may be facing, there's always hope.
Jesus has never let me down. He's always been there for me. In his word, he says that he will never leave us or forsake us. And I knew that, and I trust his word. I'm no longer the crooked lady with the broken body in the wheelchair. I'm known as the lady with the Christmas miracle.
And you can have a Christmas miracle too. All you have to do is ask believing. It's that simple. And Jesus said it, that if we have the faith of a little child, we'll see. We'll see. We'll be able to see into the kingdom of heaven. We'll be able to see him. And there's another promise. He promises that he will manifest himself to you. What does it take? It takes just a little mustard seed of faith. How do you get that? Same way you get everything. You look to him, the author and the finisher of your faith. You know, people like to say, well, you must have faith. And I go, not really. I just know some great facts. Here are the facts. God created you and me. He created us to live in a garden where there wouldn't be any problems, there wouldn't be any illness. He wants his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. And imagine, is there anybody sick in heaven? Anybody in a wheelchair? Anybody hungry? Lonely? No. No. And that's God's will, and that's what he wants for you and me. We're his children. And we messed that up. We went our own way. But God hasn't given up. He sent Jesus. He loved us so much, he sent Jesus for you and me, that whosoever would believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. And that's what Jesus came to give us life, and life more abundantly. Well, it's tough to have life abundantly when you're in a wheelchair. Jesus knows that, so he showed up for Emma, and he gave her the miracle that she needs. He will show up for you, to give you the miracle that you need. And all you have to do is believe. So Terry and I are going to agree for you. And we're going to claim this wonderful verse. If two or more agree touching anything, it shall be done by my Father in heaven. These are the words of Jesus, and you can trust them. We've got some prayer requests that we've gotten online. Sosa writes in, please pray for my 23-year-old son. He's got another brain tumor. He had an operation to remove cancer last year, but it's come back, and he's now refusing surgery. We need a miracle this Christmas. And then Tara writes in, please pray for me and my 6-year-old son, Anthony. I just got laid off, and I don't have money for Christmas to get him anything. We do not even have a tree. Please pray for God's provision for us. Let's pray. Mm-hmm. Lord, we just lift up the son of Soso to you. We also lift up Tara and her son. And we ask for Christmas miracles. We ask that you would once again be born in our hearts, that you would inhabit us and inhabit our praises of you for what you've done, how you've reconciled us to God. And now stretch forth your hand to heal. Stretch forth your hand to provide, for you supply our every need according to your riches and glory. And we just stand believing now for this son with cancer, for this household with no finances. And we say, let their cancer be gone now in Jesus' name, and let there be food in this house. Do it, Lord. Do it now. Terry, God's giving you something. Mm-hmm.
It's just a word of encouragement to the people we're specifically praying for and to all of you that God specializes in taking the little bit that we have when we give it to Him and blessing it and breaking it and making it much. He is able. He is able. Trust Him. Believe His word. Reach out your hand to receive what God has for you today.
Lord, we thank you for what you've done, for who you are,
yes,
and how you've come and given of everything that you had so that we could spend eternity with you. Lord, be with us now. Be Emmanuel, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
If you need prayer, we're here for you, and we're here for you 24 hours a day. It's our honor, our privilege to pray for you. All you have to do is call us. 888-777-1999. And I just want to add one other one. There's a lady named Sarah. You've got tremendous back pain right in the middle of your back. God just healed you. Just raise your arms and thank Him for what He just did for you, and just receive that miracle into your body. Terry?
Well, still ahead, we roll out the red carpet for a star-studded event like no other. We're going to go behind the scenes for a Superbook movie night. Don't go away.
Want to add sparkle to your home without adding stress to your life? Making the holiday season a memorable one is easier than you might think. Just ask Kimberly Whitman, editor-at-large for Southern Living Magazine. Known for her elegant style and creative entertaining tips, she shares her most festive decorating and food ideas with the 700 Club. How you can fill this Christmas with memories that will last a lifetime. On the 700 Club, next.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
With every episode of Superbook, the stories of the Bible come to life on a screen. Well, recently, the kids at London Bridge Baptist Church got an early Christmas present because they got to see some characters from Superbook coming to life in front of their very eyes.
It's a packed house at London Bridge Baptist Church in Virginia Beach, Virginia. That's because it's movie night, and everyone has come to watch their favorite Bible animated series, Superbook.
It's creative, and it tells you about God.
It's a good movie.
We always say garbage in, garbage out. There's no garbage in these movies. It's the Word of God. It brings the Word of God to life.
The concepts of sin, redemption, creation are all explained in a way that children understand it.
Many of the kids were already Superbook fans. They love the characters, Chris and Joy, but there's one that seems to be everybody's favorite.
Gizmo.
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 He's a funny robot, and he's funny.
Then they learned they had a special guest. It was their favorite robot.
Gizmo! Gizmo!
The audience was captivated as they watched three episodes. In the beginning, the first Christmas, and the Last Supper. These families know what many others do. Superbook is more than just fun and entertainment. It's a great way for kids to learn about God.
It's based on the Bible. It's based on truth, facts. It's not going to be based on something that somebody just made up from their own mind. You know, it's going to be God-inspired.
It actually puts face to Moses, puts face to Adam and Eve. They can identify with they are real people. That's why I like it for my children and also for my children in my classroom.
I think it's really good for kids because it's like from the Bible, but just like a kid's version.
I love the responses. The children love Superbook, and you can be a part of taking the stories of the Bible to the children of the world. What do you have to do? Just say, I want to be a member of the Superbook DVD Club. And every time a new episode of Superbook is produced, we'll send you not just one copy, we'll send you three. Right now we have a special Christmas offer going on where you can get three copies of the story of Noah and then three copies of The First Christmas, all for a gift of $25 when you join the Superbook DVD Club. And then as new episodes are created, you'll be first in line to get them in the world because you've contributed to the production costs, the translation costs, the distribution costs of Superbook to get the stories of the Bible to the children of the world. Our goal over the next now 4 years is 300 million children to see the stories of the Bible. We're about 10% to our goal. So far, our ratings reports show over 30 million children have seen these stories. So you can be a part of it. And be a part of the distribution because the reason we're giving you so many episodes is you can share them with your friends and family, with your church, and be part of doing exactly that, taking the stories of the Bible to the children of the world. So join with us. If you want to get caught up on the previous episodes, season one of Superbook, there's a way you can order individual episodes on CBN.com. Do it now. Call us now, 888-777-1999. Terry?
Well, up next, all this mother wanted was another child, but this pregnancy wasn't going to be easy.
I started cramping and experiencing spotting, and by the end of the day, it had progressively worsened.
Why she was determined to have the baby, even though doctors saw no signs of life.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the total transformation free.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Candace and Dennis Gaines wanted a full house, so they were thrilled when Candace became pregnant with their third child, until doctors told them that their baby's heart had stopped beating.
Dennis and Candace Gaines love celebrating Christmas with their family. Recently, we brought you the amazing story of baby Grace, whose heart stopped for 3 weeks during pregnancy. Doctors saw no hope.
My husband and I had been trying to have a child for about 3 or 4 years, and I had experienced previous miscarriages.
This time was a little different because we decided we were going to take God at His word, and we were going to trust Him no matter what.
I found out I was pregnant at maybe 6 weeks or so. Then maybe about at my 2-month mark, I started cramping and experiencing spotting. And by the end of the day, it had progressively worsened.
The fact that she had already had an ultrasound 4 days earlier and then had a heartbeat, I was convinced that she would now be able to give her some good news and allay her fears. And unfortunately, that was not the case. The ultrasound showed you could see the fetus, but there was no cardiac activity. And so I sent her over to the hospital where they also did an ultrasound and again came up with the same diagnosis of a fetal demise.
It was at that point, I think, after receiving the bad news and where we had to decide if we were going to accept it or not.
But for some reason, this time around, we just weren't willing to accept, you know, what the doctor had said. You know, we really wanted this baby. So we began praying that weekend, and we were very confident, you know, that when we went back in Monday morning that we would have good news.
But they didn't hear the report they hoped for.
And once again, there was no heartbeat.
I was convinced that this was a pregnancy that was, it was over. But Candace and her husband were both adamant that they felt that this pregnancy was going to continue.
We really trusted God and we believed that this could happen. We went and bought baby clothes and started making plans and buying swings and that kind of thing. But when we're connected to God and we're trusting Him, nothing is impossible. We read the Bible constantly. We meditated on scriptures. I had 3x5 cards that I carried around with certain scriptures. And we just saturated ourselves in our environment.
The doctor reluctantly agreed to give them more time. But when they went for a third ultrasound, things had gotten worse.
Not only was there absent cardiac activity, but the baby had not grown. The growth of the baby had, you know, she was lagging 2 weeks behind, where the growth it should have been at 7 weeks, she was only measuring 5 weeks. So it was all consistent with what we know to be a miscarriage.
This is the latest technology, you know, and just seeing the monitor where the heart should have been beating, there was nothing there. This time it actually showed us where a blood clot or sac had begun forming underneath the fetus.
I said, you know, all right, this faith business, that's great, you know, the first 2 weeks, but it's time to get down to business here. I even told them, because they said, well, we're not sure. And I said, well, I'm sure, but I even told them that. I said, I'm sure, the doctor across the street's sure, we're all sure that this pregnancy is going nowhere, but you have to be sure.
In the face of impossible odds, Dennis and Candace refused to give up.
We surrounded ourselves with godly people. We surrounded ourselves with people who knew how to pray and had faith in God and knew the power of prayer.
3 weeks passed, and the doctor became very concerned.
My concerns were, and this happens, is when pregnancy fails and it's not doing well, eventually it can become, there can be infections or heavy bleeding and hemorrhage and all these other complications from not going after and taking care of this.
Time had run out and the baby had to be removed. The day the Gaines met with their doctor, Dennis had one last request.
This time we were going to come in and make plans because now it was a question of her health. And I said, you know, I don't buy that God is not going to move. I don't buy it. Let's check one more time. Let's see.
So I walk in the room. There was no apprehension on her face. I was the one that had all the apprehension. And we did an ultrasound, and there was a heartbeat. And you know, it's nothing short of a miracle.
He's like, there's a heartbeat. There's a heartbeat. And I just, for some reason, I couldn't look at the monitor. And I remember looking over and glancing at my husband, and he just had his hands up, praising the Lord. And I'm just staring at Dr. Terry Berry. He was just so excited. And he was like, no, look at the monitor. There is a heartbeat. And I'll never forget, it was 141 beats per minute. And all I could say was just, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
All I could do was praise him and just thank him for honoring his word.
It was just glee and joy, pure joy. Because we had sat there, we just witnessed a miracle.
On April 2nd, 2008, Grace Gaines was born and is a perfectly healthy baby girl.
I think for me it represents God's awesome power and that he cares about our situation.
It doesn't do any good to really know the Bible if you're not going to apply it. So for me, it was actually taking everything that I have learned, everything that I knew about God, everything I knew about his word, and actually walking it out.
You know, I'm one speck in the entire existence, and he thought enough about our family and about honoring our faith to give her a life where they said there was none. It's knowing that God cares and that God is there for us and seeing what he's done. And he's no respecter of persons. What he did for us, he can do for anyone.
Dennis and Candace know that they're celebrating Christmas this year because God answers prayer.
Just having her here and seeing God's face in her every time, every morning is just going to be incredible. This will be the best Christmas yet.
Understandably, what an amazing miracle story.
And we were talking while the story was running, and I don't know if I'd have the faith to last those 3 weeks, knowing the potential health effects for my spouse if you don't go forward with the medical procedure to remove.
Well, and test after test after test over a period of time.
And then doctor after doctors. And when doctors start to get mad at you,
there's a reason, usually.
But anyway, if you want to stand in faith, we're here for you. We want to help you with that. That's why we've got this 24-hour prayer line. So if you need someone just to agree with you, to say, yes, God's able, give us a call. 888-777-1999. Well, we've gotten some questions from people online. Emily says, my doctor just told me that I have thyroid cancer, and it's possible that it's spread. I don't know what to do. I don't want to burden my family, especially at Christmas. How can I tell them that I have cancer?
I tried to put myself in your position, Emily, when I read this. I don't know that I would tell them at Christmas. I think I would wait until the holiday is over, and I would celebrate wonderfully with them. And, you know, at this stage of the game, it sounds like there's still a lot of speculation about whether this has spread or not. You know, believe and then trust God with it when the holiday is over and you're starting a new year together as a family. I would tell them and just say, let's come together as a family and commit in prayer. I'm a strong believer that you tell people around you that you know are prayer warriors and that will pray with you. You tell your family, you tell your closest friends, and you ask people to take you before the throne. He is the Lord our healer, and that's what I would do.
You can wait as long as there's no, it's not going to impact your health. If the doctor is saying you need surgery now, well, then you need to start telling them now. That's all the time we have. We leave you this word from Matthew. Where is he who has been born King of the Jews? for we have seen a star in the east and have come to worship him.